Yeah, you can start.
Okay, great. Great, so let's go to the agenda slide. Great, so this is the final working group meeting of this year for WASH in the supply chain. And we're really happy to share the results of the member consultation that we've conducted both in these monthly webinars that we've been having since June, but also some one-to-one calls with different members. And so we've tried to synthesize that into sort of what we've heard, and what we really want to use this meeting for is a little bit of discussion and ideation around how WASH4Work can really support your goals for WASH in the supply chain going forward, and also some discussion around the different support areas that you think would be most relevant for your supply chain partners. And we've then hope to get to a point in these two webinars with this idea sharing to put forward a work program for next year. So those are our objectives and our agenda for today. Hi, Amanda, welcome.
Hello, sorry.
And as said, we're running the session two times today. And so we have half of the working group here and we'll have the other half this afternoon. So the objectives of this working group were really to understand the developments of leading practice on WASH in the supply chain since this piece of work that was done in 2016 by WaterAid and the mandate and WBCSD to see how practice has evolved, and then also to share learnings on different approaches with the objective to create this support program for suppliers coming up in the next years in WASH4Work, which we've been piloting this year with Xylem's supply chain partners. Next slide, please. So from this, synthesis, what we learned about current leading practice on WASH in the supply chain, that most of the companies we spoke to, have WASH included in some way, some more explicit than others in supplier codes of conduct. So that seems to be leading practice. Also, incentives in place or being discussed for particularly tier one suppliers, we heard more of a prioritization there. We also heard, and this is a development from the previous work in 2016, a lot more focus in support for suppliers and with the supply chain on WASH and behavior change and more so gender equity as priority elements of programs on WASH in the supply chain. And this was the case I know in 2016 as well, but most of the companies that we've spoken with, Xylem, I think you're the exception, were coming from the agricultural and textile sectors with suppliers in those value chains. And so there has been some specific work around the development of specific WASH policies and solutions for those specific contexts. So that's sort of the update in terms of an overview of what we heard from the companies that we spoke to about their current approaches. I will call out that I think many companies mentioned that they're still at the beginning, of this journey and really interested on, how we can collaborate to move forward and scale up efforts with suppliers. And some of the common challenges that we heard were really that understanding of the size of the gap. So data, and we're going to hear about that a little bit more in the slides that we've prepared. But really data on the size of the gap of WASH in countries where companies have operations or where their suppliers are is both at the global level limited and also at the company level limited. Also, in terms of reporting, we didn't hear of many companies that were requiring reporting on actions and targets of their suppliers. And we'll give a nod to some of the other work going on in WASH4Work, which could be an opportunity there. We also heard from some of you that there's increasing expectations from sustainability reporting best practice on to disclose risk exposure linked to WASH in the supply chain, and those requests are getting more specific. And so also what we're in the process of doing is looking into what some of those specific expectations are, and having a dialogue with these reporting and disclosure organizations to understand the types of things that they're going to be asking for in the near future. And finally, it did arise that the evolving climate, and health risks from the COVID-19 pandemic are disrupting WASH service resilience. So there's a recognition there that even where companies have been investing and understanding that there are risks there, and therefore also opportunities to address those risks via supply chain partners. Maybe I'll just stop here and see if this is resonating with those on the call, or if there's anything that you would add from your perspective. Okay, we'll keep pushing through. So what we've done in the next slides is try to pull out, some of those risk areas for companies getting started on their journey of WASH in the supply chain. So these are some of the, key risks mentioned by companies that we spoke to in terms of the business case for action. So worker health, safety, and productivity, of course, but also security of business critical raw materials, particularly in agricultural supply chains. There was quite a few mentions of the direct effects on women who are dominant in the workforces of agriculture and textile supply chains in particular. The point on climate change already disrupting the water cycle and including WASH services. This is a stat from the session at World Water Week, where CDP shared that they had interviewed 10 companies who priced the risk of WASH, including the supply chain, to be about $6 billion. And we're encouraging companies to really understand the monetary value of that risk of lack of access to WASH. So that's on the risk side. And then on the opportunity side, next slide, please. So also from the work coming out of recent reports this year by WaterAid and UNICEF and the most recent report from the Joint Monitoring Program on WASH, that there are significant opportunities here, both to unlock value for the business, that there is a financial ROI of investing in WASH, with some new evidence from the case studies that were launched at World Water Week. Also on resilience for people linked to climate resilient and water resilience strategies. And also an opportunity to help address this 4x acceleration being called for by the Global Monitoring Program on Progress towards SDG 6. Next slide, please. So we pulled out here some of the data. One idea that we had is, how close can we get to really understanding where there are overlays in terms of the size of the need that global stakeholders have identified in different countries where your suppliers are operating. And even if we have a collective sort of country level view, could that be helpful in terms of prioritizing actions and even collective actions. And so as you can see here, I think the main takeaway from the joint monitoring program's most recent report of 2020 is that we need a 4x acceleration of services across all dimensions of drinking water, sanitation, and hygiene. And if we break that down, you'll see sort of where the priority geographies are, which I think probably many of you know, but what we wanted to get to is what we would like, and think is an opportunity potentially for WASH4Work to support here, is to get to a better level of understanding of the size of the need per country, and then overlay on where members, WASH4Work members and their supply chains are operating. So if you see in the next slides here, there's a breakdown. And also what's mentioned in the JMP report is the data gap. So more countries are reporting on water and access to water than sanitation and hygiene, menstrual hygiene, which you'll see in the next slide. So there's an opportunity here to overlay supply chain priority geographies with the greatest need being identified at the country level. So this is something that we thought could at least help to set a goal, a target, and an understanding of where's the baseline and where are we trying to get to in order to measure progress on WASH in the supply chain. And the next slide shows sanitation. So you see here a greater need, and although also some areas with insufficient data. So across Africa, Latin America, and Asia. Next slide, please. This is the picture for hygiene. There was even less data here, but where there is data, are in these regions of Africa and mostly Southeast Asia. And again, the thinking here is to obviously start to work with the countries that we do have data and where there is an overlap with your suppliers' operations. Next slide, please. Interesting also that report mentions menstrual hygiene and the ambition to also get more data on menstrual hygiene indicators, which also came out as a priority from companies in terms of gender equity. And so there is some data emerging here. Next slide, please. So with that picture of how leading practices emerging, some of the common challenges identified and the state of global data, we just thought we would link to some of the other work going on where there might be some opportunities where WASH4Work could help support efforts. So the first one is the Water Action Hub as a tool. If we could click through one more slide and we'll go through each of these, Juliana. So an opportunity to use this tool to link up supply chain actions for maximum impact. Many companies mentioned the interest in working together with global companies with suppliers in common, for example, or in geographies that are in common. And so I know that our colleague Leo has been working with the WASH4Work members to try and get your projects up here, but this is an opportunity also for the supply chain to really understand where those linkages are and how this tool could help facilitate linked up actions to be able to accelerate those actions and share investments. Next slide, please. Also a link to tools for suppliers and maybe I think Andrea, you're probably touch on this, the learnings from the pilot with Xylem's supply chain companies. But what we found is that, you know, many of the companies are at the beginning of their journey, especially on washing communities. And so the critical self-assessment tools to really understand what is the status of WASH access in their own operations and further to their own supply chains. Also, WaterAid has a tool for capacity training with suppliers in different contexts. So there is already some guidance here. And what we've been piloting this year with Xylem is trying to make these tools available and provide deep dives and other companies sort of sharing their experiences with implementation. So that's one area that we can continue. Next slide, please. Link to the data point of really, you know, an understanding or opportunity to capture more data on supplier actions and their own impacts. We have this tool in development for standardized accounting and reporting on WASH, which could also be a tool for supply chain partners. And finally, linked to the point and the challenge around climate impacts, really with this sort of new consensus around the actions that can be taken and a framework for action on climate resilient WASH, that could also be a tool for the supply chain. So just to summarize, I think that there's been progress here from that 2016 assessment of companies' approaches to WASH in the supply chain. And I think we also have more tools that are coming online also for suppliers. And so we're really interested to have this dialogue today with the working group on the areas that where you think WASH4Work can particularly support your actions with your supply chains and also some of these broader common challenges. So we'll get to that in just a second. But first, Andrea, thank you for sharing Xylem's approach to WASH in the supply chain and maybe some insights from the pilot that we've been running with your suppliers who are implementing the WASH pledge.
Yeah, thanks, Cheryl. And as you were talking here and presenting the few slides prior, I was just thinking out loud, you know, that we have very different supply chains. And so it's okay that we have different approaches in terms of how to best address WASH with our suppliers. In the end, you know, as long as we can though measure the impact and, you know, make sure that we are addressing it in the right way and prioritizing in the right way, it's great that we can all come together and take different approaches sometimes. So happy to share once more what we've been doing. Of course, with your support, and before that with WBCSD. So if we go to the next slide, you know, here we really have, I feel like I'm preaching to the choir to this group, but, you know, for the rest that will be listening to this webinar afterwards, I wanted to share that really Xylem has always been really focused on solving water. Of course, this is our vision and our mission and around sustainability. That is why we have committed to taking action on the various United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. And though as a water company or a water technology company, take leadership role when it comes to water stewardship. So WASH has always been very important, of course, very important factor of water stewardship, strongly interlinked with the successor of all other SDGs. So Xylem has signed the WASH pledge and came across the WASH pledge in, I think in 2018, that's when we signed it. It was a no-brainer for us. And we really tested it out as a tool for measuring ourselves. How are we addressing WASH within our own companies, but also communities and value chain? And what can we do in terms of setting priorities and goals to have a bigger impact? And that's when we realized that it was really important to have targets and programs running for all the various functions to address WASH with our business partners. That's the only way that we can have the impact that we would like to have. So if we go to the next slide, I would be sharing our framework on the left-hand side, our sustainability framework, and just the fact that you can see we have very specific goals for addressing WASH for our employees within our supply chain and within our communities. We estimate that most of the work that we do with our customers and most of the revenue that comes to Xylem is addressing SDG number 6, just because of the nature of what we do. And that is why this is a main and key priority for us when we look at our corporate social responsibility and how we also partner not only with customers by providing the solutions, but in our customers' communities and in our supply chains communities as well. So that's when we started asking our supply chain and our supply partners to also themselves start looking inwards, start thinking about WASH and sign the WASH pledge to take that first step to build their own commitments to addressing WASH within their own space. So that's what you will see if we go to the next slide. The fact that, behind these targets that we have set, there's a lot of work that goes into. There's teams that are driving each one of the targets that we have there for 2025 for supply chain, communities, and for our employees. And this is quite an investment from our side, but we are really committed to saying that WASH here, you can see, is part of our 5 supply chain sustainability goals run by procurement. Procurement is measured on how we address these topics with our suppliers. And we also really tied it to our supplier evaluation and sourcing processes. So no supplier of ours can be strategic or preferred to us if they haven't joined their sustainability journey in general, and in particular signed the WASH pledge by 2025. So that is just to show, how behind the scenes of these goals, there's quite some work going on and strong commitments. And so this is what we've been asking our suppliers to do since January 2020. If we go to the next slide, I'll just walk you through some of the learnings that we've had there, which have been quite a few. You can just click through here. I think there's an animation. So since January 2020, we had more than 500 of our suppliers at company level join us and sign the WASH pledge. And what we have learned is that what was really key was to provide education opportunities for our suppliers. That's why, Cheryl, we came up with, hey, we should have webinars, every once or every 2 months that walk through and deep dive into implementing one part of the pledge. So that's what we've been doing. I think also from this year, we'll have some more learnings and we can definitely improve the program for the coming year. But I think this has been a big resource of, providing a big resource for our suppliers, even if they then go and listen into the webinars afterwards. I have been asking Juliana, for example, hey, please, can you make sure these are posted on the website? Because, whenever I get questions, and companies and suppliers tend to come directly to the customer or whoever has asked them to sign the WASH pledge or take a certain commitment, and they come and ask for us to ask for help directly, we can at least link them back to the great resources that we've built together. So that's been key. We've also been driving very specific targets that have been linked to our own procurement's functions performance that we track year over year. So each procurement person, category manager, or site buyer has KPIs to drive this program forward. So that has been also key for us to keep the momentum going. And just engaging our partners through our own corporate social responsibility program has been a good way to show, hey, we are there for you to provide one-on-one support if you need to implement WASH within your own value chain and communities. That seems to be the bigger thing that scares suppliers when we ask them to join us. They're mainly manufacturing companies and service providers, not, nothing in agriculture, for example. But still, you might think it should be easier for you to have a handle on WASH, especially in your company. And you should be able to think about how to address WASH within your own value chain and communities, but that's where they need the most help. So that's been a really big learning for us, that depending on the industry as well that the supplier is in, they may be less or more reluctant to join in the program, and they just need a lot of support to get started and understand what it is that they need to do, and easily, you know, they need to easily get the tools to then say, okay, I know exactly what to do in the next 3 years. I have a plan. And this is also not going to be an extra topic that I address, you know, in the next 3 years, but it will be part of my sustainability journey. So that's also something that we've learned that is key for suppliers to realize since the beginning. And overall, once they do realize that, they do take pride in joining us. They do take pride in showing the work that they've been doing on WASH as part of their sustainability journeys. So we just need more of these examples. And I think I have one more slide, if we go to the next one, that we shared last webinar that we had with the suppliers. And this is something that I've been getting more and more questions about. So how can we partner with whoever asks us to sign the WASH pledge, or anyway with other companies that are working on WASH, to take action in the community side? This is, as I said before, the main source of hesitance that we see from companies that, you know, are asked to sign the pledge. And so what we have done is to put out there, you know, the resources and the partnerships that we have to work on WASH within our own communities, you know, available to suppliers or whoever wants to join us through volunteering within your communities. We also have various partners for whom we raise funds to address WASH in larger communities and value chains that we may not be directly present in. And we also have a community impact grant program. So we said to suppliers and to whatever stakeholders we have, if they would like to run a WASH related project with a local NGO or a partner that we are not involved in or involved with, they can do that. They can apply for a grant up to $10,000. All they need to show is that they meet criteria for volunteering time, number of people involved, the number of people impacted, and then we would grant them this grant to do the work in their own communities. So the resources are there. It should be easy for suppliers to get ideas, and we hope we can really scale this up next year. What I think would be even greater than this is coming all together with the help of WASH4Work, having more examples of this sort that other companies and various industries can also get involved in. This is what we have for our suppliers, but I'm sure that there's a lot more out there, for example, through the Action Hub that can be leveraged. And I think with that.
Thank you, Andrea.
Yeah, back to you, Cheryl.
Yeah, just one question. I mean, you know, I think for our group here on reporting. So, I mean, are you, just from what we've learned from some of the other companies on, you know, what they're seeing from the sustainability reporting and disclosure requirements, are you seeing that change there where, you know, you're being asked to report on WASH, you know, lack of access to WASH and the exposure and risks in the supply chain?
So in the supply chain specifically, no. What we do have, you know, that is being asked on a regular basis is, you know, our CDP reports for water. We also do the TCFD report, which does obviously address water risks. And, you know, with that comes WASH. But we haven't seen any specific requests from, for example, investors or customers to specifically report on WASH access or risks within the supply chain. We are doing the work ourselves before we're really asked to do that. And it's a tricky thing to measure. I think we're still, we got up to a good place with measuring our impact through our partnerships and our volunteering and various projects with the NGOs that we run. So the impact that we have on the number of lives that we impact, that's what we report on a regular basis. But with the supply chain, you also need to take it, I think, sometimes a bit more slowly and get into the mindset of, hey, this is something that is important for all of us to do, and then look for the reporting, especially if, as I said, investors or big customers are not asking or pushing for it yet.
Thank you. Thank you. And maybe Christine, since we have you on the line from AWS, I don't know if you want to come in on from an AWS perspective on reporting and watching the supply chain. I caught up with Scott last week, and he mentioned the work that you're also doing at AWS on watching in the supply chain.
Yeah, we're doing a couple of things. I'm particularly interested today, not dodging your question, but I'm particularly interested today. Obviously, we've been a part of WASH4Work for a number of years, not myself personally, but super interested in obviously promoting the resources that come out of the particular working groups to actually implement certification at sites. But I'm entering into this, doing a lot of thinking through of how we will take the standard revision process in the coming years. And it's one thing to say that AWS will start to more explicitly engage with the climate issues. And so that's I'm particularly interested why today is super. It's not just an add-on, but we have to imagine, integrate it and layering it across all the outcomes. And so that's why your research, speaking, hearing directly from the suppliers and the companies about how that might look. So that's something that I'm particularly interested in today. So that's why I would like, what Scott in the supply chain, it's not part of the work that I do, so it might be part of more of the working groups.
Okay.
We have so I work in system integrity, and I make sure that all of the systems behind the AWS system are credible and fit for purpose, and that's really from the standards and assurance and certification piece. In terms of reporting, then it's not so much what I work on, it's more about how we influence and provide guidance and those tools and things, so that companies who've already done some WASH and they're like, now they have to add on the climate piece. And for them, I think that's quite a complicated space, because they may feel or experience that maybe that investment hasn't been, we want to get them targeted as soon as possible, in the most effective way. And climate change is creating so many additional complexities, what that might look like. Anyways, nice to see you.
Thank you.
We met years ago.
Thank you. Yes, I remember.
Face to face, small personal. Thanks.
Thanks, Christine. We'll definitely follow up on that. And maybe if Jillian, if you could bring the slides back up. We wanted to start our discussion, and Michael has kindly offered to share his reflections, both from a Diageo perspective on your approach to WASH in the supply chain, but also for WASH4Work, where we can add the most value here in terms of helping to scale up your efforts and perhaps break down some of the common challenges.
Thanks, Cheryl, and thank you, Andrea, for a very helpful summary there. I think you said at the beginning, Andrea, that different companies have different supply chains, different perspectives, different ways of doing it, and it's what the value of WASH4Work is and pulling it all together. So I really appreciate that. Quickly on Diageo, what have we done? We've done a slightly different approach to Xylem, or quite a big approach, mostly because of the risks in our supply chain. But Xylem's approach is fantastic, and it's wonderful to see the level of support you've got from your suppliers. So we were a signatory of pledge, quite early signatory of the pledge, and since then we've been implementing it internally. And that's really should be a must for all companies. And I'll come to that in a second. But we've also, for many years, probably a couple of decades now, been investing in our upstream supply chain and our agricultural supply chain, where WASH is the biggest risk, and mostly in sub-Saharan Africa and other water-stressed markets around the world. So investing in that upstream supply chain with suppliers to bring WASH to sparsely populated rural communities that are supplying us with our raw materials is a key part of our strategy on WASH. But we've also introduced some more generic recommendations for our suppliers in our partnering with supplier code, which is our kind of supply chain code for suppliers. you know, mentioning it there, encouraging it there, and then more recently introducing it into contracts. So mostly with a carrot rather than a stick, if you follow me, but you know, referencing it within contracts with suppliers, with our key suppliers. So very much raising the profile, but recognize that we need to do more generically. We've traditionally focused a lot on agricultural supply chains, as I mentioned, but we need to do more with our broader supply chain. So why WASH4Work? Why are we members, and why do we think WASH4Work is the best forum for driving improved action and uptake, if you like, of commitment to WASH? Well, it's a consistent common approach for all suppliers. That's critical, because our suppliers will also be suppliers to other big companies. Indeed, some of our suppliers are bigger than us, but it's really important to have a common approach, and not everybody to have a different approach and a different demand and a different recommendation. I think when suppliers are supplying more than one customer, as it were, a large customer, then it's really helpful to have that common approach. And we know that kind of duplication and multiple reporting and multiple auditing is a big headache for many companies. I think the other reason why we support it so strongly is because of the pledge itself is a kind of North Star, if you like, to really drive action. Many companies need that kind of target and structure and framework to really drive action in their business, rather than saying loosely you should be doing more and WASH. It provides that kind of drive and milestone or target for companies. Also provides the tools and the to help deliver that, as Andrea said. And I think really important is a network to support. So there's a good practice network, as it were, with objective experts on this group that can advise and develop materials which are well-founded, credible, and pragmatic to implement for suppliers and supply chains. I think that's really important. And as much as anything, really, the WASH4Work is a kind of awareness campaign as well. So we need to do more and more of that. The UN Water Conference in March next year is a massive opportunity for WASH4Work, and we've discussed that in the steering group and continue to do that to make sure that really we're raising the visibility of WASH as an integral part of good corporate water stewardship and climate resiliency. So what are the challenges? Well, we've touched on some of the challenges, but very briefly, I think I mentioned at the outset, I think WASH4Work, or WASH in the workplace as such, is a non-negotiable, and that is something that we can all drive and demand. And I mean that in terms of a factory setting. So when you put a factory or manufacturing site or anything, that, you know, the basic human right to water and provision of good quality WASH for your employees and visitors is essential. So that really should be non-negotiable, and you know, Diageo ourselves should be driving more awareness and compliance, if you like, with that, and we've got plans to do so. I think some of the challenges in agricultural workplace are much bigger because of the sparsely populated, just the nature of the workplace. It is more difficult to do there. I know some companies that we don't own our agricultural land, but some companies do, and that makes it difficult to provide adequate WASH over a large, you know, land area that might only be visited occasionally. Or you know, not every day. So I think those agricultural settings are a challenge, but they're not, you know, they can be overcome, and they can be pragmatic responses to that. And that's where WASH4Work can provide that. And we've discussed that in the past, where we think there can be pragmatic solutions to, you know, these challenges, particularly in agricultural supply chain. I think one of the other challenges is, I think Andrea maybe touched on it, is, you know, the perception that it's not our responsibility, that it's a government responsibility to help with WASH and to invest in WASH, and it's not a private sector responsibility. I think through the AWS, through the CA Water Mandate, through other water stewardship initiatives, I think there's greater, but not complete, recognition that to be a good corporate water stewardship, you have to be addressing the WASH risk if there is that in your supply chain and in your business. And you can't be a good water stewardship just by a steward by improving efficiency and improving quality discharge if you're not addressing that WASH risk. and addressing it holistically across the supply chain and in the catchments where you're operating. So really fundamental is the recognition that WASH isn't just a government responsibility, it's a responsibility of business as well. And then I think the final challenge I would say is around funding. We certainly position, and Diageo certainly position this as a important investment to secure long-term growth and license to operate. It's not a CSR, it's not a discretionary at the end of the year. It's absolutely fundamental to, where appropriate, WASH isn't a risk in all areas, but where we're operating and WASH is a risk, that we should be addressing this. And without addressing that, we can't continue to grow our business as we plan to do so, and we don't have a kind of a credible license to operate. So that's really key for me, is recognition from businesses that this isn't a CSR kind of philanthropic kind of investment. This is a, for many businesses anyway, operating in water stressed areas where WASH is a risk, that this is a fundamental requirement to underpinning the growth of your business. And so really that's it for me. I think the kind of collective ambition of WASH4Work is hugely important. It's kind of based on that kind of human right to water and businesses need to, or requirement to really participate in this and invest in this. I think it's recognition, our call to action through the recognition around climate and community resilience. It has to start with people. It starts with people and climate and then business. And certainly ourselves and many other businesses are at the forefront of this impact of climate change on our supply chains. And the first thing we need to do is provide WASH to kind of unlock the solution for those communities to be more resilient to climate change, and therefore be more support the resilience of our supply chains. And that the final call is really just to scale up and accelerate. I think we're always saying that, but it's so important to recognize, you know, the Water Resilience Coalition has a big target of 300 million by 2030 in terms of WASH beneficiaries. Other companies have similar ambitions. It's really, really important that we set these big goals, that there's leadership from the very top to drive the scale and pace that we require. So I'll stop that there, Cheryl, and hopefully that kind of gives a few thoughts to stimulate the discussion.
Thank you, Michael. Thank you for that. So I am just floor is open for others to come in just on thoughts on some of these areas where WASH4Work and this platform can particularly support our collective ambition. Any other thoughts? I know Andrea and Michael have shared. Christine, you shared the areas that you're interested in. Amanda, Christina, any thoughts, reflections from your side?
I don't know if my camera's coming on. There we go. I am. Just to reiterate my observation around increasing granularity of data around the number of people affected. So we have quite a lot of data at the country level, maybe even at regionals. But, and maybe this is a challenge to myself, to have a better understanding of how that national data is compiled. Was it all added up from a very granular level? Have we just made big assumptions and extrapolations? Because what the trend I was seeing in the corporate human rights benchmark, and also in human rights questions around from DGSI, was, yes, have your policy in place and have a contractual requirement for your suppliers to have a commitment to this. The next step then is, how are you actively working with your suppliers to make sure that policy lives in practice through training and incentives and the guidance and the great stuff that, you know, WASH4Work has already put together. And then the next level of sophistication then is really understanding in a quantitative way where we're producing and sourcing, how many people don't have access to WASH, and who else is operating in and around that community, to work out what our fair share is and where we could do collective action together to tackle that. At the moment, our WASH is very directly linked to water replenishment. So there's a logic of our fair share for how much of water we're using in our direct operations, and WASH being one of the ways that we meet our replenishment targets. But I don't currently have visibility to say with confidence exactly the number of people, where we are, and whether we're doing enough, and the right size of the investment for Diageo on its own, and the right size of investment and opportunity for Diageo to do stuff collectively. So anything that helps me get access to that data right now will feed into the next iteration of a more stretching strategy beyond contractual commitments, working with suppliers a bit, but not really stopping working with them necessarily, or, you know, to properly tracking progress and reducing the number of people around our operations with a lack of access to WASH, and being able to demonstrate that in a quantifiable way is where my head's at. So anything you can do to help on that mission, I would welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Amanda. And thank you also for the deep dive that we had the opportunity to speak with you earlier in this process, which also helped to shape that thinking, you know, around some of that data that we can leverage from partners that are partners of WASH4Work, who have kindly provided us with some of the data that we shared today. So thank you for that suggestion. Katrina, do you want to come in with your reflections?
Yeah, sorry, and I was actually late. I was having trouble joining, so I actually only caught the back end of Andrea's. Now, I think it's good to see the different approaches. I think we've still got a way to go in terms of increasing the number of signatories with our suppliers, and I think certainly I like the idea of having it embedded into a contract. So that's something which we will do going forward, and just keeping it really at the forefront of the discussions that we're having with our suppliers. So I think we're still very much on a journey, a long way to go. And certainly, a big next step for us is actually embedding this in the kind of day-to-day conversations that we're having with suppliers. Because at the moment, it's very much been a drive centrally, I would say, from our central procurement team and our category management team. But really, we want to have this very much embedded in the local discussions as well. So, yeah, but no, thank you for sharing what you have so far.
Thank you. Thank you all. And maybe just to provide some ideas here, which hopefully weave together some of your comments and more broadly from what we heard from the other members. These are just some ideas that we wanted to put in front of you, which I think follow up to the presentation earlier. Juliana, can you show the next slide on opportunities for 2023? So one thing that we thought we could perhaps dig a little deeper into is this mapping of the collective size of the gap. To your points, Amanda, we have the WASH expert partners at the table in WASH4Work, who are compiling these numbers, and so I think that is something that is doable. And from our earlier conversations, we've talked to them, and they've already started to provide us with some data. And the opportunity here could be getting that country level data, and as you say, really understanding which WASH4Work members are working in those areas, or even more broadly to the CEO Water Mandate and Water Resilience Coalition members, to really understand the size of the gap, in communities where you and your suppliers are operating, and like you said, where there's opportunities for collective action there to help close that gap and measure progress, and so that's the thinking behind this collective business ambition. So if we have that data, and we can work together as this working group in the next year to really come up with, okay, once we have that data and we have that better, understanding, what is our collective ambition, and how can we, work together to close some of these gaps, both to for the global goals, but also, of course, as was mentioned by Andrea and Michael, for your own business goals, of course, as well. So that's something we thought, we'd be well placed to do, having the right people around the table that are holding, that data. How can we help to bring it more out into the open in a way that that's most useful to companies and in terms of engaging suppliers as well. And then also, I think what was mentioned and something that we can help with is really looking at how to make some of these new tools available in a way that's most useful for suppliers around climate resilient WASH and around these new accounting and reporting methods again, so that we can continue that understanding, you know, of both the size of the gap, but also how progress is being made. So these are some of the ideas that we had for opportunities for 2023. You know, what would be where we're well positioned to help support the work moving forward and also continuing to make sure that the tools that have been developed, you know, are available and are continuing to be improved to be most relevant for also your supply chains. Any final comments before we come to a close?
Sorry, Cheryl, I'd love to discuss these more in more detail. I like all of these opportunities. I think mapping the size of the gap, you know, if you guys can provide some sort of guidance on how we would do that and what we should look at, I think coming with a common approach would be great, but also connecting members to collective supplier actions. I think that's where it really is for us in terms of, you know, what we think the priority would be for scaling impact. We might have suppliers in common, we might not, but it doesn't matter because, you know, probably suppliers will be located in similar areas, be connected to the same watersheds, the same communities. So that would be really a great one to work on together.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think that's the one that stuck out for me was the third one. I think that's where the real value can happen in this network. I'm not sure about this collective business ambition. I think most companies have already got their own targets, and then if they're not, then maybe the Water Resilience Coalition's got its target. So it feels like maybe it's not a target, maybe it's just an ambition rather than a target. But either way, we've got that declaration, haven't we, that we at COP27, I think, you know, leveraging that further with in the light of UN Water Conference in March, I think would be great. Size of the gap is a tricky one. Where do you start and where do you stop? And many companies will be doing their own catchment risk assessments to really understand what the challenge is there. But I understand that there's a gap. And I think Amanda shared earlier some new data that's coming out of a USAID approach, that's a supported approach from Gallup, so that's so that's quite interesting. But I would be focusing well, that as Andrea said, that third bullet point, really, how do we help them, particularly if they're SMEs, what's the network that can be adopted that can help them implement in their supply chains rather than just in their own factories. They should be doing it, but if they've got factories indeed, but and offices. But beyond that, what's the opportunity for collaboration?
Great. Thank you. Thank you all for sharing your reflections and ideas on where to prioritize and where we can add value. So we'll take this forward to the next.